promoting pro-development investment agreements and policies. And this is based on the premise of investment, which is seen as a panacea for development. Investment is very important with regards to job creation, with regards to increasing revenues to the government, contributing to the overall industrial development process, which is an objective and a development aspiration for many LDCs, as well as developing countries alike. But for investment to live to these promises, there is need for appropriate policy frameworks in place. And because of that, we have seen countries negotiating a number of bilateral investment treaties, coming up with investment policies, setting up investment promotion agencies, all with the ultimate goal of attracting foreign direct investment. But we have also had challenges, and we have challenges with regard to jobs, industrial development, environmental considerations, as well as, labor issues. And because of this, we thought of organizing this session as part of the Trade and Development Symposium. With me, I have on my left, Ambassador Nathan Irumba, who is the Chief Executive Director of CIATINI. CIATINI is Southern and Eastern African Trade Information and Negotiations Institute. He has been Uganda's ambassador at Geneva and has coordinated the LDC group in the WTO negotiations, and with vast experience in multilateral diplomacy. So, Ambassador, you're welcome. Next, on my right, immediate right, I have Ms. Jane Nalunga, who is the country director for CIATINI, Uganda. Jane has, over the last decade, also been actively involved in following up and influencing the multilateral processes, the WTO negotiations, as well as the bilateral processes, especially the economic partnership agreements. But she also has vast experience and interest in investment issues, in ensuring that investments deliver on the promises for development. So Jen, you're welcome. And then lastly, I have Sanya Reid, Ms. Sanya Reid Smith, who works with the Third World Network. Sanya has been so instrumental in coordinating advocacy on the multilateral processes, the WTO negotiations, as well as on investment as one of the new issues that is being put forward. She supports Third World Network, which CIATINI as well is a member, with regard to research and technical support and sharing of information. So, Sanya, you're welcome. I'll start by giving chance to Ambassador Nathan Irumba to give his submission. He's going to talk about the global dynamics of investment and its implications for Africa. So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin, for that introduction and for putting us in perspective. My topic is to give the global dynamics of investment agreements and how these have implications for Africa. I always try to go back to history. Some of us who studied history, even economic history, it's good to look at how the past informs the future. When we look at the subject of investment in Africa or in colonial period and in the post-colonial period, at least immediate post-colonial period, many of the emerging countries at that time were concerned that the investments which were done in the pre-colonial period were not so much aimed at benefiting the host countries. So if you look at countries like in Africa, which were much resource, with many resources, DRC were my neighbors, even for us in Uganda, you find the exploitation of the resources of the people and which the investors were putting in were meant essentially for the metropolitan powers. There was very little, there was not much which was at least in the perception of the both independence movement post and the, those governments at that stage, which they saw as benefiting, increasing the human development of their citizens. So there was that quest, how do we make investment be useful for the human development, for the development, the economic development, transformation of the country. So there was a sense of tension, where everyone could see. So on the part of the investors, also there were a fear that what might happen is that there was a fear of nationalization. So the first generation of investment agreements, which were bilateral agreement, for much of the investors was how do you protect their investment from nationalization? That was the major fear in the, if you look in the 60s. Whereas the government was looking at how do we make the investment serve the indigenous? And how do you, so the first generation of investment agreements, you look at your bilateral agreements, were mostly trying to assuage the fears of the investor. So that if it is expropriation, there should be prompt payment of compensation. And then the other aspect which the countries or the government were concerned was how is it you take control of your natural resources? So did you gain sovereignty of your natural resources? So you look for the debate in the 60s and 70s, the United Nations was everywhere. If you look in the history of the debate and the records, there was a debate of gaining, we were talking about gaining the sovereignty of our natural resources. There was a fear that these were being expropriated. I mean, were you being exploited, not so much for the benefit, and how do we ensure that benefit takes place? Again, there was also a fear, a concern that of the need of to develop a code of conduct for the transnational corporations. I was in New York in the 70s, in the 80s, and there was a center for transnational cooperation. There was a feeling that corporations and transnational corporations have so much power. And of course, there are certain incidences which I always talk about, which are not nice incidences, like somebody wrote about the bitter fruit, where governments have overthrown to the bitter fruit that is in Guatemala. I think it is in Guatemala, but anyway, it's in somewhere in South Africa, where government was overthrown because of the dispute they had over the I think there was an attempt to nationalize the fruit companies, those who were growing bananas and what you. So the Abenzi government was overthrown. So there was also that kind of thing, that a fear of that a transnational corporation would become so powerful, and then they may not be working in the interests of the. So the developing countries were pressing for a code of conduct. And the Center for Transnational Cooperation, the UN, was put into place to try to develop a code of conduct which would work beneficially. But the code of conduct, with the advent of the ergonomics and such as there is no alternative, never saw the light of day. And in the restructuring, actually, the Center for Transnational Cooperation was more or less closed and reincarnated as a department of on invest for investment under UNCTAD in that restructuring exercise which happened in Eton. So the point I'm making, since then there have been evolution, particularly after the structural adjustment program. There is now a recognition that investors play a key role in the development of a country. And then we have adopted some of the national visions and the development plans where FDI is seen as a source of financing which not trade, the debt creating. So most of our countries have had to put in place liberal investment regimes with a view of attracting investment. And the hope is that we should be able to get technological know-how, we should be able to get forward and backward linkages, we should be able to get skills. That is, many of these studies, that these are not automatic. You can have a liberal investment regime, even a liberal investment agreement, but it doesn't necessarily mean that actually you'll benefit. It will translate into actual investment or intellectual human development. That requires the government to take on certain frameworks, policies, or even regulations which will make the investment work. Now, looking back at my years of experience in the WTO, I've worked with the WTO, I've been following the WTO since the 90s. I followed up the Uruguay round. I was there at the creation of the Doha round. Now, for us in developing countries, we find that there is an attempt to create international regimes which would have free movement of capital. But free movement of capital without adding on responsibility on what this capital will have to do in the host countries. So immediately after Uruguay round, we were told that there was a drive to have in WTO investment agreement. Even in the OECD, there was a multilateral investment agreement, MI, which was being negotiated, but of course there was quite a lot of commotion both within the developed countries and the developing countries about what would be the service of this MI. Will this just protect the capital without actually helping the people? Is it that who even labor itself? So there was that debate which was going on, and I think it's still going on, whether we should have an investment regime, a investment agreement negotiated within the WTO. But that as it may, I think most of LDCs have agreed, see the need of attracting investment. And they have put those frameworks for attracting investment. But very interestingly, if you look at the flow of investment over the last so many years, it is those countries like China, which didn't have a liberal investment regime, which were attracting investment. Even when South Africa was under apartheid, it was attracting more investment than many of the African countries, which means there's certain things an investor looks at. He looks at the market, he looks at stability, he looks at the resources, and he looks at the skills. Whether or not an investment agreement actually contributes is still debatable. But whatever it is, that might not be it, but it might still be useful to have in it. But then the catch for the host country is the kind of investment agreement you take in, and the kind of the generation of investment agreement which are coming out, which literally means you giving up some of the possibilities of directing what the investment can do. I have been looking at some of the investment agreements. They usually take the United States model investment agreement. What do they ask you? They want a national treatment of expropriation, which means includes a regulatory taking. And cases have been happening recently about where people have been trying to implement free entry and no performance requirements. Why didn't the Tobacco Convention? And Philip Morris has been taking them to dispute settlement mechanism, many of which have resulted two in terms of awards by this international ISSD, quite big awards. So the point I want to make, if you want, you need an investment agreement which is pro-development, but you must be careful. You don't now constrain your ability to make to adopt measures that will make that investment more productive. So how do we make it productive? So how do you have a win-win situation? The win-win situation, I think, as far as our concern, is the one in which the investor would have would have reasonable repatriation of profits, but she should have also some obligations. I'll take the oil industries. If you look at my friends from Nigeria, there has been a lot of pollution, a lot of the oil, but they have not been able to get these oil companies to do the cleaning. Whereas in Florida, the other time when there was mishap and the oil spill, because the U.S. is powerful, Shell was compelled to pay. But if you see what kind of the damage of the environment which has been done in Nigeria, Nigeria can, because it doesn't have that power, it has not been able to compel them to pay. So, as I say, in Africa, we have gone from one ism to another. We have gone through at a time when we are suspicious to a stage where we open up under structural adjustment, and literally now in every country there is investment regimes, many regulation, investor codes, which actually attract investors who are very good, friendly for investment, but the surprisingly, the investments have not been coming. But when we look at the multilateral level right now, and as I say, in July 2004, under the July package, we succeeded to say that we let the competition policy grow investment. We shall deal with them later. But now, the impasse is over the so-called 21st century issues. And what are the 21st century issues? 21st century issues are investment, competition policy, government procurement. And now, these are rules, if we're not careful, which would constrain the ability of our governments to carry out, to use investment as a development tool. Now, investment, if not regulated, it can be a poison chalice. Although it might not be debt creating, it can actually, it's a promise that if somebody will repatriate his profits. And if you over incentivize you might find that even the profits are, the repatriation of the money is might be more than what was brought in, and the mispricing. If you look at the TNC's mispricing, that's one of the problems which we have, which we are grappling with in Africa. Transfer pricing, which has been there has been a commission headed by Mbeki, which has made a recommendation about it on how to make an investment more friendly. So why we want investment, we need to have an appropriate framework which is good both for the investor and for the host country. As I say, we should be very careful about the definition of what constitutes an investment. Where you have got this casino economy, speculative money going around, and which can cause volatility that could be skewed. I think we have to have a good definition of fair and equitable treatment, so that the question of rights of both the investor and the host country are respected, and we have to avoid this broad definition of expropriation, which apparently now has tend to include a regulatory taking. I think we should be very careful that we keep this, that space. And and then when we come to dispute settlement mechanism, we have to be very, very careful on where we're going to settle our disputes. As the evidence shows recently, many countries are trying to withdraw from this World Bank, ICSD dispute settlement, because the kind of judgment which has been coming from those from that institution seem to be generally against developing countries. And I think we need to be very careful on how the kind of dispute settlement. Let's first exhaust the dispute settlement at the country level. But most importantly, we must strengthen in LDC the role of the state. Unfortunately, over a period, the state has been seen as a problem rather than a solution. And yet, for us who don't have a big private sector to talk about, we need to empower the state even to collaborate with the private sector to be able to go to spur certain investment. Chair, those are some of the things I thought I should let you know. In sum, we have there have been a changing environment. Initially, of suspicion. Now, welcoming the TNCs, hoping that they can transfer technology, they can give us skills, but also making sure that they live up to the obligation, the expectation that we expect. Not only taking, like in the WTO, so we have been fearing that. We have had this lopsided liberalization, but will the investment create work? Will the investment help us in our transformation exercise, or will it be merely extractive? Those are the issues I thought we should be able to address. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Nathan Irumba, for your submission on the global dynamics. Briefly, just a recap. He talked about the importance of investment, but bringing in the need for an appropriate policy framework to ensure that investment delivers. And then he talked about the need for us to be cautious, especially on the clauses on the investment treaties. For instance, the definition of investment, which is always wide and may pose a danger. the definition of expropriation, fair and equitable treatment. These are some of the issues that we need to clearly look into if we want our investment policy framework to contribute to our development aspiration. He brought the historical perspective from the post-colonial era in Africa, the issue of bringing investment in the WTO, which currently what is being discussed just behind us at the convention center is one of the main issues, the new issues that developed countries, especially the US, wants to introduce in the WTO agenda. So thank you very much, Ambassador, for that. Secondly, I will invite Sanya Reid to also bring submissions, especially from the LDC and the lessons which we as LDCs can learn from the progressive investment treaties, the model treaties countries like South Africa, India, Ecuador have come up with. So welcome, Sanya.
Thank you very much. So as we heard, investment is one of the issues that may be decided here in Nairobi at the WTO Ministerial Conference because some countries would like to see it added back to the WTO negotiations, even though developing countries said that they could not be part of the Doha round, which is currently being negotiated. So if they do agree across the road in the KICC to have new issues in the WTO, and that includes investment, what might that look like? So the US model of bilateral investment treaties is a very strong template. It's very hard to change their model, and we can see that, for example, in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which was concluded this year, and even 11 other countries could not make any significant changes to the US model investment treaty, which became the investment chapter of the TPP. So if investment is added to the WTO here in Nairobi, what we might end up with is the US model investment treaty with all the implications that that has, which we can see from existing cases under past US investment treaties and free trade agreements. It of course also means that for the East African community negotiating an investment treaty with the US, it's likely to be very difficult for the EAC to get any changes to this US model. So if we take a step back, why do countries want investment? They want it because they hope it brings in jobs. You know, if a company comes in and sets up a new factory and employs 10,000 people, they might want it for technology transfer, thinking that the multinational company will bring in the latest new technology, hopefully transfer it to the local companies. They might want it to employ and train locals. They might want it for balance of payments, to get some FDI coming in. But depending on what the investment rules are, they can restrict the ability for countries to make sure that this foreign direct investment actually benefits development. For example, if the investment rules that may be added here in the WTO include liberalization, then governments may no longer be able to require joint ventures, to say the foreign investor has to form a joint venture with the local company so that the local company can learn by doing, by working alongside the multinational, a kind of indirect technology transfer. Or if the government wants to require foreign investors to employ and train locals, that's not allowed in sectors where you make national treatment commitments. Or if investment includes restrictions on performance requirements that go beyond the current WTO rules, known as TRIMs, and extend it to, say, services, or not being allowed to require technology transfer from foreign companies, or not being allowed to take measures to keep technology affordable when the local companies are licensing from multinationals. And this, of course, has implications for the climate change rules, where some developing countries are saying we want affordable technology transfer, and, of course, in manufacturing generally. On the balance of payments issue, although foreign direct investment brings money in, typically the investment rules that you get in investment treaties, which may come to the WTO, also require the money to be able to go out, that the foreign investor can send their profits home, and that the governments cannot restrict that. So typically, since investors will only come in if they can make money, they're not a charity, they're the private sector, say they bring in $1 million. Every year they make $100,000, and they send that home. After 10 years, they have sent home more, or 11 years, they have sent home more than they brought in. And this is actually what happened to Malaysia. Malaysia was very successful in attracting foreign direct investment. And every year from 1990 to 1996, except one year, Malaysia would have had a current account surplus, except that the foreign investors were sending their profits home sending them out of Malaysia. So it actually had a current account deficit every single year because of the foreign investors sending their money home. And it's not always true that foreign investors actually bring the money in. They might borrow from local banks rather than actually bringing in new money. So they may not be bringing in the money to help your balance of payments. And what happens when there's a financial crisis, like the current global financial crisis? Iceland has been using capital controls now for what, seven years. Those kinds of capital controls are not allowed by some of these investment rules, depending on the treaty, even in a financial crisis. Or if you're allowed, it might only be on outflows and not on inflows. So if you have too much money coming in, you can get asset bubbles, which can destabilize, cause house prices to be unaffordable for locals. Then when all the money runs out, you have another problem. So you may not be able to use capital controls on inflows either. So why are countries looking at investment treaties or investment protection rules or even investment liberalization rules? Do these bring in foreign direct investment? There have been a lot of studies of this, and there's not really any clear evidence that this does definitively bring in foreign direct investment. For example, the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development in their report last year found that results do not support the hypothesis that investment treaties bring in foreign direct investment. So developing country policymakers should not assume that signing up to these investment rules will increase foreign direct investment. And as Ambassador Arumba said, the World Bank has said that the main drivers of foreign direct investment are the size and growth potential of your markets. If you have a big population, China, India, Brazil, you will always get lots of companies wanting to come in and set up a supermarket to sell to your people. Other studies show that investors want to have access to natural resources. So Nigeria, Angola will always have lots of FDI because they have oil. If you have good infrastructure, your electricity doesn't go off 10 times a day, your ports are not jammed, your roads are not full of potholes. If you have good human capital, these are the main drivers of foreign direct investment. And when you actually ask the foreign investors and you ask the companies that give political risk insurance to foreign investors and you ask the risk rating agencies who say how risky your country is, do they consider if there are these investment protection rules before they give insurance, before they do risk rating, before they invest? The basic answer is no, they don't. They look at other factors. These investment rules are irrelevant to them. And we can see, for example, that Brazil has no investment treaties in force. They negotiated 14, but under the Brazilian constitution, they had to pass the Brazilian parliament and the Brazilian to come into force. And the Brazilian parliament refused to pass any of them because they said it restricts their ability to regulate too much. So Brazil has no investment treaties in force, and yet they are the fifth largest recipient of foreign direct investment in the world, number five, because they have a big market and they have natural resources. So foreign investment comes anyway, even though they have no investment treaty. So what are the lessons learned? A lot of countries have been sued under bilateral investment treaties and free trade agreement investment chapters, both developed and developing, and a lot have lost. And so they've learned that these investment rules can be used by foreign investors to successfully challenge a wide range of regulations, including health, environment, industrial policy, the measures you take in a financial crisis, your sovereign debt restructuring, and so on. So what has been the response? Some countries have decided to withdraw from these investment treaties. For example, Indonesia, Ecuador, South Africa, they are withdrawing from their investment treaties. Even in the US, the state level parliaments, all 50 states, regularly say, they pass a resolution, we do not want investors to be able to sue our government, no ISDS. And yet their trade negotiators keep negotiating it, as was recently the case in the TPP. Of course, the French, Dutch, Austrian, and so on parliaments are also concerned about ISDS. So what have countries learned from these disputes and that they put in their models or they change in their models to try and avoid these problems happening again? Ambassador Arumba mentioned fair and equitable treatment. This is a common provision that you have to treat the foreign investor, the host government has to treat the foreign investor fairly and equitably. Sounded very nice, we all thought no problem, why not? But this has been interpreted by some tribunals to be a standstill on your laws and regulations. So no new laws, no new regulations, no changing them if that harms the foreign investor. But there are often external factors that mean you have to change your laws. We learned about this thing called climate change. Now we need to regulate and reduce emissions. There's been a financial crisis. We need to re-regulate. we learned that thalidomide is bad medicine for pregnant women. Don't give it to pregnant women. Vioxx is dangerous. BPA in baby bottles, the plastic, you should ban it. So we often learn new things and we have to change our laws and regulations. But this fair and equitable treatment is the most common way of suing under the US investment treaties and free trade agreement investment chapters. So 74% of the time when investors win, it's a violation of this fair and equitable treatment. And fair and equitable treatment has been found to be violated in 81% of the cases when the investors claim it was violated. So they almost always win when they allege this, and they almost always allege it. So the Brazilian model investment treaty that they have recently concluded has no fair and equitable treatment provision. They say it's too dangerous. It restricts our policy space and ability to regulate too much. So although we have a new model treaty, there is no requirement to treat foreign investors fairly and equitably because it's too hard to restrict its meaning. It's just too broad. What other governments have learned is that under these investment rules, it's not just the national government's laws and regulations that can be challenged, because these are often binding on all levels of government, so your provincial government and your local or city governments. So it's quite common that the provincial government or the local government violates the investment rules. Then the national government is sued because they signed the treaty. National government loses, national government has to pay the money to the foreign investor, national government tries to get it back from the provincial government whose fault it was for violating the rules. So this happened to the Mexican government. The national government tried to get the money back from their provincial government, but they could not under Mexican law. Canada's provinces regularly violate the North American Free Trade Agreement investment chapter. National government keeps getting sued, keeps losing. Canadian government said enough. The provinces have to pay now when it's their fault for violating these rules. So India and their model investment treaty have said, look, it's too hard for us to control what all those local governments are doing across India to make sure they comply with these rules, so we just exclude them from our model investment treaty. The Indian model treaty does not apply to local governments. Because in some countries, constitutionally, the national government may not be able to control what the provincial or city governments are doing in certain areas. Or it might be a different political party who wants to do something different to the national government. And again, they can't control. Some other cases have been sovereign debt restructuring. So when the government can't afford to repay their debt, they do a haircut, like Greece did. In fact, they were forced to by the Troika. So when you do that, like when Argentina did, you can be sued under these investment rules, and then the governments can lose. So because there have been a lot of these cases, even the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement has a partial exception for some sovereign debt restructuring from some of the investment rules, because they've learnt the lessons from these cases challenging sovereign debt restructuring. Then what about when the investor breaks the law in the country they're investing in, the host country? So you would think that if the investor breaks the law, maybe they would lose some of their rights under these treaties. But usually that's not the case. Under the standard old investment treaty model, when the investor breaks the law in the host country, they can still sue the government and still win all the money. So we see, for example, the Occidental Oil Company broke the law in Ecuador. They transferred shares without permission. And then the Ecuadorian government punished them, as they are allowed to under their law, by cancelling their permit. Occidental, the oil company, sued the Ecuador government under these investment rules at an international tribunal. And the international tribunal said, yes, we agree, Occidental, you did break Ecuador's law, but still, Occidental, you win, and the government will pay you $2.4 billion. So this is called paying the lawbreaker. So you pay the polluter, you pay the person who breaks your health laws, you pay the person who breaks your tax laws. So India learned their lesson from this, and in their model investment treaty, if the investor is corrupt, or the investor does not pay the taxes, or the investor does not comply with India's laws, including on labour, environment, human rights, then the investor cannot get the protection of this investment treaty. They can't sue the government for enforcing their own laws. So what is this all about in terms of suing the government? This is the investor-to-state dispute settlement, which allows the foreign investor to sue the host country they're in if they think the government has violated these investment rules that I described. And typically in these investment rules, the investor is allowed to sue for an unlimited amount of monetary damages, so pay them money. So recently a government lost a case and had to pay $50 billion, 50, and the government had 180 days to find the money. So that's in an investment treaty. If you don't pay, they start to seize your government's assets around the world. if those rules were brought into the WTO and the government couldn't find $50 billion spare lying around in 180 days, then their failure to pay could be punished by the home country of the investor, say the US, raising the tariffs on, say, Kenya's exports until they pay the $50 billion. It would be an extra layer of enforcement. But even when the governments win these cases, 70% of the time they still have to pay for their own lawyers. And paying for your lawyers can be $58 million in one case. And in these disputes, when the investors sue and you go to some international tribunal, the rules for the judges, the arbitrators, are not necessarily what you would expect. The conflict of interest rules are either weak or non-existent. For example, if the investor chooses to go to the World Bank Tribunal, ICSID, there have been a number of famous cases where one of the three arbitrators, the judges, was on the board of directors of the parent company of the investor suing in that case. She did not disclose this. The investor won the case. Argentina, the government who was sued, found out and they appealed. And they said, please, how can you be so closely affiliated to the company suing me? And on appeal, the World Bank Tribunal said, you know, it's okay. We trust the arbitrator to do the right thing. The investor still wins. The same arbitrator went on to do the same thing in another case, also okay under the World Bank rules. So some countries have learnt their lesson and said, if we have these rules, we're going to add conflict of interest rules, that the judges cannot have such conflicts of interest. So that's an attempt to do that has been put in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and the Canada-EU Free Trade Agreement. It's not clear if they will be strong enough, but there is an attempt to at least have some conflict of interest rules. So the statistics show that when US investors sue, they sue twice as often as the next most litigious country's investors. And when you look at all the publicly available ISDS cases to 2010, it shows that they get a broad interpretation of their procedural rights 98% of the time. So they're very successful when they sue. So because of these ISDS problems, in the Brazilian model investment treaty, there is no ISDS. If the government breaks the rules, the investor cannot sue. Full stop. No ISDS. So, some of the other problems that we've seen from these ISDS cases is when they, for example, challenge health and environmental laws. So, when Canada banned a dangerous chemical that was harmful to health, they were sued by the manufacturer of the chemical, and the Canadian government settled. They said, okay, we reverse the ban. You carry on selling your dangerous chemical, and the Canadian government paid $13 million to the manufacturer, and the Canadian government issued a statement for use in advertising saying that current scientific information does not demonstrate the toxicity of this chemical. Canada banned another chemical that they thought was dangerous to health and the environment. Again, they were sued, and this time they lost, and they had to pay $5 million to the manufacturer for the lost profits that the company would have made for the 16 months of the ban. In Mexico, there was a toxic waste dump that the government was worried would pollute the water supply, so they didn't allow it to go ahead. They were sued, they lost, they had to pay $15 million. And there's a number of ongoing cases. For example, in Peru, there is a metal smelter that processes metal that is polluting the area so that 99% of the children have lead poisoning. And the government had to declare a state of emergency. The government asked the investor to clean up. They gave them two extensions. The company didn't clean up, so they shut them down. The government is being sued for $800 million by the polluting investor. Of course, the Philip Morris cases are the famous ones that Ambassador Arumba mentioned, where Australia's plain packaging on cigarettes to have no logos and just the big gruesome picture of lung cancer is being challenged by Philip Morris under a Hong Kong Australia investment treaty, and the tobacco companies asking for billions of US dollars just for that law. So because of these kinds of cases, India learned their lesson and they say, okay, in our model investment treaty, we have health and environment and other exceptions. That's not standard, surprisingly, in some of the old investment treaties, and it's certainly not allowed by the US in their model. So the health and environment exceptions in the TPP exceptions chapter do not apply to the investment chapter because the US blocked it. So the last thing here is some countries, when they decide to withdraw from the investment treaties, have problems because they have what's called a survival clause that says even when you withdraw, the foreign investor can still sue you for another 5, 10, 20 years. And so some of the countries who have withdrawn already are still being sued under these survival clauses. So the Brazilian model learnt their lessons, and the Brazilian model investment treaty has no survival clause. So hopefully this gives some ideas to any countries in Africa and least developed countries who are thinking about having investment treaties, about some of the best practices that we other countries have learned from the cases so far. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Sanya, for that very good submission. Briefly, Sanya talked about should investment be taken in Nairobi, we are likely to take the U.S. model investment treaty, which will negatively impact in future negotiations and on the development objectives of LDCs. She reiterated the reason for attracting investment with regard to jobs, technological transfer, addressing the balance of payment problems. But with these issues, she again identified the challenges we have with the current frameworks. For example, transfers, which limits still the need, which limits the ability for countries to address the balance of payment problems. And also the fact that these investors can still borrow domestically, which beats the overall understanding of attracting foreign capital. She dwelt very much on dispute settlement, giving a number of examples like Ecuador, the processes financially draining to poor economies and the cases they lose, but even if they don't lose, still the legal costs are very high. And these are the issues that need to be addressed. So at this point, I would like to call upon our last speaker before we give chance to the floor to give their submissions. I will call upon Jane Nalunga to give her submissions, especially from the EAC angle and looking at the model investment treaty, the lessons which that is being developed currently at the East African community, but also the lessons which we can learn from the progressive investment treaties in place. So, Jen, you're welcome.
Thank you so much, Chair, and good afternoon, comrades. I'm going to share experiences within the region, because the East African community will have the East African states came together in an East African community. These are five countries: Kenya, where we are now, Rwanda, Burundi, Tanzania, and Uganda. So I'm going to share experiences in terms of what they are doing around putting in place investment, an ESC investment model treaty, and the challenges therein. As Sanya and Ambassador have pointed out, the issue of the investment issue is a contentious issue. And today here in Nairobi, it's one of those elephants in the room, you know, the whole issue of the new issues, whether the new issues are going to be put on the table or not. And one of those issues is the investment issue. The ESC partner states have as individual countries concluded a number of bilateral investment treaties with a number of countries. They have also put in place investment policies and investment codes. When you look at these investment policies at their partner state level, the investment codes and policies are so liberal, very open, you know, in order to attract investors. So you find that most of those investment policies are talking about investor rights without any obligations, without taking into account the rights of the host states. So you find that investment policies include issues of the right to establishment, national treatment, issues of expropriation, no performance requirement, transfers and all that, you know. At the moment, the ESC partner states are going to negotiate a number of investment treaties. One of them is with the US under the Trade and Investment Partnership Agreement. The US has already put their model investment treaty on table, and what the US is looking at is just for the ESC to put their mark somewhere. Again, the ESC has concluded the economic partnership agreements with the European Union. It's remaining with a ratification, but within the economic partnership agreement, there is that rendezvous clause, which states that the partner states have to conclude a number of agreements within 5 years. And one of the issue there is the issue of the investment. Because of these two negotiations, the ESC agreed to come together and put in place an ESC model investment treaty. This model treaty would help them to negotiate with third parties like the US and the EU. And that the model treaty would also help to guide investment policies at partner state level. But it would also address the whole issue of the race to the bottom. Because at the moment, there is a lot of competition for investors. When Tanzania says, I'm going to give you to give an investor a tax holiday of 5 years, Rwanda might say 10 years, Uganda might say 25 years. So there is a lot of competition for investment. In this investment model, at least the ES partner states are drawing lessons from the South African investment model. They are also drawing lessons from the Indian investment model. We have been part of this process. At least our governments are considering changes in a number of ways. For example, they have put there in their investment model the right of governments to regulate, investments in order to achieve sustainable development. They have also put there a number of rights, like human rights. But what we have learned from this process is that governments still fear that when you put issues, for example, human rights, to limit transfers, to put there issues of performance requirement, that you are discouraging investors. So you find even if we have that policy space to be able to come up with very, very good investment models, our governments are reluctant that in case we put there some limitations, we might not attract investment. So you find that when you look at the draft investment model treaty in place, it still lacks a number of issues, and it still includes issues like national treatment, issues of transfers, issues of expropriation. What we have done, and I think what's important to do, is to be able to do more analysis of the implication of the traditional model investment treaties, their implication to specific sectors and also to specific people. For example, we have tried to bring on board in this conversation around a pro-development investment treaty. We have tried to bring on board trade unions so that they can be able to talk about labor rights, SMEs, small and medium enterprises, Sanya has talked about, issues of joint ventures under performance requirements. They are not there. So we have tried to bring on board SMEs for them to be able to talk about joint ventures. We have tried to bring on board people working in agriculture, especially in areas of land-based investments, people working on human rights, so that they can talk about a human rights impact assessment. We have been advocating strongly for a human rights impact assessment to be included in any investment treaty, so that governments can impel investors to carry out human rights impact assessments of their investments. But this is also an uphill task, because governments were saying no, because you see, when you put issues of investment in a model treaty, we don't understand human rights in the same way, so it might be a problem. So still, that's an issue still on the table. There's the whole issue of people working in environment and issues of health. Sanya has talked about the article on expropriation. In the traditional investment treaties, the whole issue of expropriation has been broadened to include expropriation of lost profits. If I put in place an environmental law which is going to limit the profits of the investor, that's counted as expropriation. So we are trying also to bring on board people working on environment, people working on health, organizations working on data and aid, because when you look at investments, the return on investments, especially in Africa, is very, very high, higher than the payment on loans. So the issue of capital flight is a very big issue in Africa. So have been also trying to bring people on board who are working on debt, on aid, to talk about transfer, so that in the new investment model, at least we can put limitations to transfers to take into account a balance of payment challenges. So that's where we are. The East African community, and this example can take into account other countries in Africa, we are still grappling on what kind of investment regime we can put in place to promote sustainable development. So it would be, that's why we are a bit worried that if in Nairobi here, the whole issue of investment is put on the table before countries at national and regional level are even now, you know, haven't yet been able to say this is the kind of investment regimes we want, it will be difficult for Africa to be able to negotiate a good investment treaty or agreement in the WTO. Thank you very much.
Jane brought in the East African experience, the process in developing the model treaty. She also talked about the issue of coordinating investment at the regional level to avoid the issue of what we call a race to the bottom, where each country comes up with more concessions such that they can outcompete each other in attracting investments. And in that case, we lose the overall meaning of effort to attract FDIs. She brought in the lessons that we are learning from countries like India, South Africa on the model investment treaties. But one important issue which she also raised is with regard to policy space, where countries in East Africa, and she sees that as mostly a big challenge in East Africa, in Africa, and as well as LDCs, a reluctance to use the available policy space, but also to put such a policy space to maintain it in a model treaty, with fear that it will discourage investors. These are issues to do with efforts or strategies to kind of limit transfers, to address the balance of payment problems, the issue of performance requirements. And these are the key issues that we need if we are to make investments work for our development. she also talked about the need to do human rights impact assessment and also look at the issues of environment, health, and workers' issues in all these investment policy frameworks. So thank you very much. I also thank the panelists for keeping time. We have around 30 minutes for floor discussions, which is really wonderful. So without wasting much time, I call upon the floor to give in questions and comments. We start with around five people. I count 1 to 5, and then we'll get the panelists to answer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So number one, please, you can.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. My name is Ari from Indonesia, and I have some question from, especially for Ms. Sanya Smith. You were correct saying that Indonesia is actually undergoing this kind of not termination, like not renewing our PIDs. We have 64 PIDs, and it's been a growing public discourse in Indonesia. But what I'm interesting more to hear more from you is, first of all, it's about the TPP itself. You've been talking on some points on TPP investment clause that some part of it are actually better than the old model of PIDs, but still not yet made an exclusion on some things. But the thing is, Indonesia is currently it's on the list of the interested countries to join TPP. Would you say that if we actually join TPP, would it make our effort in terminating or all of our PIDs would be useless? That's one. And second is about yesterday, or I think it's 2 days ago, Minister Ploumen from the Netherlands mentioned about the new European Union crafted investment court system or ICS. What is your take about that? Is it better than the old PIDs model? I think both ICS and ISDS still allows investors to triumph over public policy consideration. I want to hear more about it from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Number two.
Thank you for the very insightful expositions. But maybe to start off with a comment, the information shared can be, I am from Kenya, and it can be a bit depressing to hear, because from all angles, whether it's the treaties or the policy, almost sounds like it is supposed to maintain the LDCs in their position and those in power continue exploiting them. So my question now in regard to that comment, do the LDCs have the capacity to have the interpretation of these treaties and also have a look out for the best interest? Is it a must? Is there a compulsion? I know they are in need of these direct, the FDIs, but is there an alternative or recourse? Is there a way we can just succumb? It sounds really, really depressing. And also, again, I would just like to ask if there has been absence of technical assistance or just the interpretation in crafting of these models, is there a provision for them to build their capacity, or it just remains open-ended? Then finally, what is being done to ensure that the broad interpretations of the clauses and the different aspects of the treaties are narrowed down to be more specific, or are they left to the to be between the host and the investing country? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Number three, please give your name and your organization. Number three was somewhere there.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, panelists. My question, again, go to Sanya. One, I'm glad I have seen you physically. I've been reading your works. My question is, it seems you have taken off time to look at these cases in the various countries. What is bothering my mind is that what is the state of governance in these countries? And has the state of governance got a role in the kind of decisions that are being made, especially for those countries that are opting out and are thinking otherwise. Related to that question, in those particular cases, what is the ideology that is shaping their development objectives as a country? Because I have a conviction that some of our governments are also behaving the way they are behaving because of the bitter pill that they took earlier on, meaning the ideology behind their development objectives and the macroeconomic policy frameworks that they are pursuing, and they are in there. Maybe Ambassador could help us. If my conviction is wrong, who is placing the baton and where is it pressed?
Thank you very much, Agnes. So we have the fourth person, number four.
Hello, thank you very much. I have a question regarding the rendezvous clause that you mentioned in the EAC EPA. What happens if your model and the EU model do not fit and you cannot agree on anything? What will happen then? And also, could you even change your mind and say you do not want to address this issue anymore, or address investment protection, but without giving investors the right to actually sue governments?
Thank you. Number five is there.
Thank you very much. My name is William Madio from Tanzania. I would like to congratulate the panelists for elaborate discussions on investment. And also I would like to congratulate Sertini for coming up with an international investment agreement advocacy guide for the civil society, because this will help us, civil society, to come up with ways and strategies to see how we could capture the tricky places that we could help to solve the issue of investments and the anti-development outcomes that are coming out of it. I would like to comment on the issue of investment and the idea that probably they would agree on investment issues in this MC10. It will be absurd coming up with agreeing on investment, because in 2004, the General Council, the framework actually, that was adopted, the July framework, shows and clearly that the issues such as trade, investment, competition policy and transparency in government procurement will not, as agreed by the council, will not be discussed or will not be negotiated in this Doha round, which was stated in the Doha Declaration paragraph 20 to 22, 23 to 25, and paragraph 26, that says clearly that agreeing on investment in the Doha round is not right. Also, it should not be included in the work program of the declaration. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ruth Berg, and I'm from the Trade Justice Movement in the UK. My question is a little bit about the principles behind the investment treaty. So we heard a lot about the reform efforts that are happening, but it's just a sort of reminder that, as I understand it, only about 20% of investment flows, this has probably increased since the TPP, are covered by investment treaties. The TTIP would increase this hugely, and obviously the WTO, again, would increase it enormously. But my question is, what I'm a little bit concerned about is that we don't seem to be questioning the premise behind this, because as far as I can see, these agreements are often historical, often agreed without very much consideration. And for me, the basic principle is that a taxpayer, whether it's me in the UK, if we get TTIP, or anyone else in any other country, has to insure the business risk of multinational companies. Personally, I have no interest in insuring the business risk of Walmart if they choose to invest in my country. You know, I don't see why that's legitimate, and there are plenty of alternatives. And I just wondered what the panel think about the possibility just to challenge the basic idea that these investment treaties should exist, the principle that a government should insure the business risk of companies when there are so many other alternatives they could use. Thanks.
Oh, thank you very much, Ruth. So let me now come back to the panelists. I start with the ambassador, so to give his responses to some of the questions I raised.
Thank you. I only answer just a few. One of the questions was, is the LDC in the opposition to what do they have to take these agreements? Yeah, that's really the question. Because as we said, there is no empirical evidence which shows that investment flows are guided, that investors actually are guided by the agreements. At one time I was in a meeting with in UNCTAD, where a number of investors were coming to give the experience. And I posed the question, these were big companies. How many times do you consider whether a country has an investment agreement before you make your investment decision? They said that almost all of them said that had the figures. And they repeated the question that what matters to them is what Anthony said, market, resources, if it's a resource seeking, if it is market seeking, or if it's skill seeking, and then stability. They hardly look at this investment resource, but somehow, I don't know why they're now being pushed. We are being pushed into having those investment treaties by our bilateral partners. Now, when they're in a position earlier, you know, in the enthusiasm at independence, many signed on agreements which they never understood. It's like we signed on the Uruguay agreements. When we signed on the Uruguay agreements, I asked many ministers, they did not understand them, but they asked for technical assistance to understand what they signed so that they can implement it. So the first generation of technical assistance was about understanding the Uruguay agreements. So in the enthusiasm after independence, many of these signed these agreements. And more often than not, you find when the president pays a state visit, quickly some bilateral arrangements are put together. And one of the things that you find that is even if it's not examined by the Home Ministry of both trade and justice. So some agreement is signed, and until somebody pulls it out. In fact, if you ask many of these countries how many agreements they have signed, they don't know. We have had even in Uganda to have to carry out a study how many bilateral agreements we have signed. So there is that what I would call a lack of seriousness, so it's not until somebody says, "But look, you signed on the dotted line," then there is a wake up. I think what we need to do, I've been stressing that we are having this national vision, national plan, and I still insist on the developmental state. How are these agreements contributing to the bringing of investment which will make us realize our national vision? In the material context, for the developed countries, they are clear. They want to increase their economic space, whether it be in terms of carbon space or it be in terms of trade space. And they are driven by, in attempt to by their multinationals. To negotiate, so they see it as part of the of how they will help their multinational. But for the LDCs, to me, the jury is out. I know I'm on whether they should even sign these agreements. But if they are going to sign them, that's why we're saying, please look, at least have your own objective, which are injected in the agreement. Agnes was asking the ideology and the state of governance. who's pushing the button. I think that's one of the problems we are being, because we have had for quite some time. I was talking somewhere, they said there's usually a narrative at the multilateral level which we usually get caught as, we quickly take on board without examining. So the narrative of how to attract FDI, meaning you open up without putting conditions, is one of those things which came with the Washington consensus. So, and we have not yet revised that Washington consensus. And at times it was part of the donor dependence syndrome, wanting to please others, so hoping they can be able to assist you. That's how I will look at it. Whether the investment should be at MCD, I agree with you. We had agreed a long time ago in July 2004, that was a big struggle after Cancun, that we are not ready for these issues. But what is happening now, some people want to front load them, saying the world has changed. Agriculture is still the 20th century issue, so nobody wants to talk about nobody wants to resist. So they want to push us into these issues. My own, you can put these conditions, the environment, you don't have to be tied up in this environment of investment. You don't have necessarily to be tied up with the multilateral rules. If you're going to have multilateral rules, please have those which you have also contributed and which will safeguard your process space.
Thank you very much, Ambassador, for that. So I call upon Jen Nalunga to give her response to the questions that have been raised.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. I'll start with my sister from Kenya. The issue of the capacity. Is it a capacity issue? Is it a technical issue? Do our governments, our negotiators, don't understand the technical issues around investment? They do. Ambassador there was one of our negotiators for a long time, and I believe he does understand the technical issues. Sanya here, South Center and Third World Network, they have been churning out so many papers around these issues. So it isn't a technical issue. It is a political issue. Most times our governments stampeded into signing these agreements for a number of reasons. So for me, I think the way forward is to be able to broaden the constituency of people who can be able to put pressure on our governments to be able to put in place pro-development investment treaties. And these are people whom the sectors which I talked about, thus bringing the investment, the people working on environment, trade unions, bringing health, bringing the women. So let us broaden and put pressure on our governments, on our negotiators. But it isn't a technical issue. Then the issue of who's my sister? The rendezvous clause. Like I said, we are supposed to conclude negotiations around a number of issues, competition policy and all that, including investment, within 5 years after ratification. But somebody was telling me it means ratification both in the EU and also in the ESC. But negotiations can go either way, because government has ever negotiated these issues within the EPAs, although they were not concluded. And what was agreed was we do it, after, concluding the first part of the economic partnership agreements. And during that time, what the East African community had agreed was that we don't negotiate binding rules, but we negotiate cooperation and technical assistance. But negotiations can go either way, and our experience in the negotiating with the European Union is that there is a power imbalance. European Union has been pushing, you know, the ESC and also SCP countries to conclude these negotiations. The EPAs have taken almost 12 years without being concluded, you know, but the ES concluded just because the EU threatened Kenya not to accept their goods in the European Union. So the whole ES caved in, you know, and because they didn't want to, Kenya couldn't sign on its own, you know, because the other four partner states are LDC, and they had the Cotonou Agreement and everything but arms option to fall back on. Kenya didn't have, so their flowers and fish couldn't, the European Union increased taxes on them. So in fact, we concluded the EPS because of Kenya's flowers and fish. So even the rendezvous clause investment, you can't know what stick the EU will hold over the ESC to conclude. Then lastly, the issue of the investment, should they exist? And I go back to what Ambassador was saying, who decides on what investment treaties we are concluding, no? And maybe that's one of the issues which has been put in the ES investment model treaty, that a treaty doesn't become binding on the partner state unless it has been put under within parliament, discussed and ratified. For me, that was also a plus in the ES investment model treaty.
Thank you, Jane. So, Sanya, please, you can already give your response.
Thank you for the very good questions. So on the question of the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and Indonesia, the first thing is that those countries who are thinking of joining the TPP, so it may be Indonesia or Thailand, Korea, Taiwan, and so on, need to realize that probably they'll only be able to negotiate their schedules. So how quickly you remove all your tariffs, which services and investment sectors you don't open, which government procurement, which ministries you open to government procurement, and maybe some state-owned enterprise exceptions. So it's very unlikely you'd be able to change the rules of the investment chapter, for example. The second thing is that in the TPP, the text was released about a month ago by the governments, and you can see in the final provisions chapter, the process for joining the TPP is like WTO accession. You have to get the agreement of all the existing countries, and they can demand anything they want, not just remove all your tariffs, but change your flag, whatever they feel like. So unless they agree, you can't get in. It has to be consensus. And their demands don't have to have anything to do with trade and investment. So then coming to whether joining the TPP would undermine Indonesia's current policy of basically withdrawing from its investment treaties. From a quick look, Indonesia does not currently have an investment treaty or free trade agreement with investment chapter with the US. So that would be new for you if you joined the TPP, that US investors could sue you for the first time, unless they were treaty shopping through another treaty that you haven't withdrawn from. And as I was saying, they are the most litigious, more than twice as litigious as the next country's investors who like to sue, and they get a broad interpretation of their rights 98% of the time. So you are exposing yourself to significant additional legal liability, even just by opening to US investors suing you. And of course, this also applies to TTIP in the EU. So it does seem to be different to your current policy of basically withdrawing from your investment treaties, and I understand that one of the reasons behind Indonesia withdrawing was you are being sued under investment treaties, especially by mining companies, for example, for a lot of money, and so that's caused some rethinking in the government, which is actually quite common. I mean, South Africa was sued under their investment treaties for their black empowerment policies, their affirmative action post-apartheid, and that caused the government to have a big rethink and a careful review of all their investment treaties and their compatibility with the new South African constitution, and they said, look, actually, it's not, we need to withdraw. So it's quite common that once governments are sued, they rethink. I mean, maybe it was the two Vattenfall cases in Germany, and suddenly Germany's not so keen, some Germans not so keen on ISDS and TTIP and so on. For the investment court proposed by the EU, I have to say I haven't studied it in detail, so I just give some preliminary comments, but I know there are other people here in the room who have done detailed analysis of it, which I'm sure they could share with you. Basically, it seems to be some minor changes, but still the substantive rules are problematic. For example, it's still a broad definition of investment that gets the protection of the treaty. So in old Malaysian investment treaties, they only protected investments agreed in writing by the government. So then when the Asian financial crisis happened in 1997 and Malaysia used capital controls, a Belgian stockbroker who had bought stocks on the Malaysian stock market tried to sue Malaysia because he couldn't take his money out of the country. But his hot money portfolio investment was not an investment approved in writing by the Malaysian government. So under that investment treaty, he lost. There was no protection. But in the TPP and in the EU model, these kinds of shares, intellectual property, any other tangible, intangible assets, all protected. They get the protection of the treaty, not just those approved in writing by the government. So that makes it much harder for the government to know what legal liability they're exposed to, because they can't calculate how much investment there is in the country because it's such a broad definition. And we can see what happened with a broad definition of investment when a Kuwaiti investor in Libya got a 90-year lease to build and operate a tourism complex. They spent $5 million building an office, but they did not even start construction of the tourism complex for 3 years. So the Libyan government said, look, you're not doing anything with this big patch of land in the middle of the city, so I'm going to cancel the lease and the contract. The Kuwaiti investor sued the Libyan government and won $900 million for the lost profits they would have made if they had built the tourism complex, the imaginary tourism complex, and operated it for 90 years. So they just imagined the tourism complex and they got $900 million. That's what broad definitions of investment and fair and equitable treatment and expropriation can do for you. So the EU proposal, even with their court system, still has this problematic fair and equitable treatment. There is an attempt to narrow it, and the question is whether that will work. And this comes down to the interpretation question. Who interprets it? And it's the arbitrators in these international tribunals. And so we have seen that past attempts to narrow fair and equitable treatment have been unsuccessful. So in the US model, which is also the TPP investment chapter, they have an annex saying that fair and equitable treatment is in accordance with customary international law. This was the same annex in the Central America US Free Trade Agreement, and it was tested twice. Investors sued twice, and the US even intervened. It wasn't the US being sued, it was Central America being sued by the investor. The US government intervened and said, please interpret fair and equitable treatment in accordance with this annex in the Free Trade Agreement. The investment tribunal looked at the annex and they said, you negotiators did not know what you were negotiating. We are going to ignore the annex. We will interpret it broadly anyway. Government's still guilty. So even when it's black and white in the annex, in the text, they still ignore it. So it's not clear to me that tribunals will follow the attempted narrowing of fair and equitable treatment, and that's why some investment law experts think that there's no safe way to narrow fair and equitable treatment, and that's probably why Brazil, for example, does not have any fair and equitable treatment provision in their investment treaties. The EU new model, whatever, new court system, still has the indirect expropriation, and it still has free transfers. It's unclear if there'll be sufficient balance of payment safeguards. It still has ISDS with automatic consent by the host government to being sued. It still has unlimited monetary damages. It still allows the tribunal to award, to say that the government must pay compound interest, compounded every month, from the date the government took the action 5 years ago at commercial interest rates. That's all still allowed. There's some attempted improvements and conflict of interest rules. The investor can still get paid twice. If they get paid under insurance or an investment guarantee, 100% of their losses covered, they can still sue and get another 100% covered under this new EU court system. So they get covered twice. And so basically, why did countries join these treaties? Why did they withdraw? I mean, I think they might have thought that would bring foreign direct investment, even though it's not proven to. They might not have realized the dangers because the cases are relatively recent and rapidly increasing in number. So those who have been sued often relook at them and then decide to withdraw and not sign them anymore. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Sanya. I request a round of applause for all our panelists. So on behalf of Siatini, I would like to thank ICTSD for this wonderful partnership opportunity. It's been great. We've liked the discussions, and we hope to continue with this kind of partnerships to extend our different agenda to promote development. And then finally, I'd like to thank all of you, the participants, because without you, we wouldn't have had this wonderful session. So thank you very much, and have a good evening.